Hey everybody, welcome back to Linux for Everyone and welcome home. I work from the Croatian coast every summer, so I'm outside a lot. That means I want a laptop that's lightweight with decent battery life. But you know what's equally important? Having a display that can outshine the sunlight. On paper, the new 6th generation Infinity Book Pro from Tuxedo Computers, it ticks all those boxes and then some, considering it has a 3K display with a 1610 aspect ratio and a bright anti-glare screen. But I don't like to form an opinion about hardware based on some marketing bullet points. I like to put it to work in my day-to-day routine. Does the Infinity Book Pro 14 deliver enough value, good looks, and horsepower to earn its asking price? And what's the gaming story look like using Intel's 11th generation Iris Xe graphics? Let's dig in. Okay, so let's deal with the sticker shock first. Tuxedo offers a baseline Infinity Book Pro 14 that comes with a 1080p display, a 4.2 GHz quad-core i5, 8GB of RAM, and a 256GB SSD. The starting price is about 1,200 euros, or 1,420 US dollars. That price concerns me. And look, I understand we'll pay a slight premium for Linux-first hardware, and I feel good supporting the little guys. But you can buy Apple's new M1 MacBook Air with a higher resolution display, an 8-core CPU that blows away Intel's 11th Gen i5, double the storage space, and significantly longer battery life for $150 less. We're talking about different architectures and ecosystems, yes, but I think a laptop like this needs to be a little more competitive in the price department. Anyway, you can ramp up the new Infinity Book Pro 14 to a 3K Omnia display and an 11th generation quad-core i7, which is what my review system shipped with. Now, that spec bump costs 200 euros more, which seems reasonable given the performance upgrade and better screen that you'll get. And integrated into that CPU is Intel's Iris Xe graphics, and we're going to see how it handles basic gaming in a few minutes. Now back to my review machine. It packs 32 gigabytes of dual-channel DDR4 memory and a 500 gigabyte Samsung 970 Evo Plus NVMe drive. And rounding out the core specs is a 53 watt-hour battery and an underwhelming webcam. 1 megapixel? I mean, seriously? Why aren't quality webcams as standard as a 1080p display by now, especially after 18 months of the world working remotely? On a more positive note, the port selection is perfect for an Ultrabook, and it blows away mainstream choices like Apple or Dell's XPS 13 in this arena. In total, you get an HDMI out, 2 USB-A 3.2 ports, and 2 USB-C 3.2 ports. Both of those can be used to supply power, and one of them is Thunderbolt 4. That means you can technically drive a total of 4 displays with this laptop. There's also a standard SD card reader and a 2-in-1 audio jack. What it doesn't have is an Ethernet port, but given its thinness, that's a reasonable omission. And this thing is only 1.5 centimeters or just over half an inch thick. Thankfully though, Tuxedo puts a free USB-C to Ethernet adapter in the box for you. Let's be real for a second. A lot of you have stopped caring about Intel. Anytime I post news about a new laptop with an Intel CPU, half the comments or more are just frustrated demands for Ryzen instead. Admittedly, I went into this review with a bit of a bias against Intel, and I wasn't expecting much. But Intel seems to have really stepped up its game with Tiger Lake. I mean, just last year, I was using the Lemur Pro from System 76 with its 10th gen Core i7 chip, and look at the difference. It's a completely lopsided win for the Infinity Book Pro 14. I was also evaluating the 8-core Oryx Pro late last year, 2020. This bad boy puts up a great fight. And look at how it performs against the ThinkPad P53, which is another beast. So let's clarify something before we move ahead. During my unboxing video, I mentioned that I'm reviewing a pre-production model, which plainly exhibited a loose display hinge. Now, Tuxedo had a comment pinned on that video, which you can check out, and they've assured me that's not present in the retail version that you can purchase right now. And really, I doubt they'd even sell it in that kind of condition because it would just get returned. I've also heard from a few early customers that it's perfectly fine, so no worries there. Anyway, whenever I see a commercial for a monitor, you know how the on-screen images look like they're fake, like they're kind of painted on there? Because most of the time, they are. They're put in there in post-production. But in the real world, especially indoors, this display has such crisp image reproduction that it looks painted on. And this is largely thanks to the 14-inch screen and the 2880 by 1880 resolution. The pixel density here is, it's dense. Then you consider it has 400 nits brightness and a gorgeous LTPS anti-glare screen, narrow bezels that you'll barely notice, and yeah, this is one of the best mobile displays I've ever had the pleasure of using. We're still not at the point that we can comfortably play any game with integrated graphics, but it's getting close, and Intel's Xe graphics are a sorely needed step in that direction. I tried a handful of games like Risk of Rain 2, Doom from 2016, Hades, and all the footage you're seeing is captured at 1080p using low to medium settings. It still looks good, and they're all playable at over 30fps. I consider that a win for such a thin and light ultrabook. Gaming at this system's native 3K resolution, though, that might be a little too much to ask of this CPU for any graphically demanding title. But if you connect an external GPU, you've got yourself a more than capable gaming powerhouse in a premium portable package. Linux for Everyone HQ, it's like a revolving door of laptops, and I'm always banging away on different sized keyboards with various layouts. If you're a writer, a programmer, extra talkative in our Discord or Matrix, or just happily married to your keyboard, you'll probably agree that can be just as important as display quality or the system's overall performance. After using the InfinityBook Pro 14's keyboard for a few weeks, I'm confident saying the typing experience is great, even though it's an international German version with that way too tiny left shift key. Maybe it's the overall size of the chassis, the spacing and size of the keys, or the subtle but satisfying travel. There's really nothing special about it, but I can hammer out my thoughts pretty quickly and pretty error-free. Now, the keyboard deck does have a little bit of flex to it, but honestly, it's nothing to detract from the experience, and it's understandable given the diminutive size of this laptop. It's also worth mentioning the glass trackpad here. It is roomy, it's accurate, and it just feels really smooth in action. And I also appreciate how it extends to the bottom edge. That, for me, the overall size of it and the positioning of it is great for audio and video editing when I need to be accurate, but I also need a little bit of room for my fingers to run around. Okay, so Tuxedo's own Ryzen-powered Pulse 15, it just embarrasses other laptops when it comes to battery life. I was able to consistently get 10 to 11 hours, and that was with brightness at 50%, Wi-Fi and Bluetooth both on, streaming 1080p video the entire time. If you want marathon battery life, if that's the most important thing in your hunt for a laptop, you can just stop searching. Just go buy the Tuxedo Pulse 15. That being said, this laptop only has a 53 watt hour battery compared to the Pulse 15's 91 watt hour battery. Of course, that smaller battery capacity means it can be lighter and thinner, so it's a bit of a balancing act. You won't stay unplugged all day with the InfinityBook Pro 14, but you can manage probably 4 to 6 hours without a charge under light to medium working conditions. Your mileage may vary, of course. My standard battery life test involves lowering the display brightness to 50%, leaving Wi-Fi and Bluetooth switched on, and streaming YouTube at 1080p until the laptop just gives up. For this test, my 3K InfinityBook Pro lasted 4 hours and 11 minutes. But this display is really bright, and because the handy Tuxedo Control Center makes it so easy to create custom power profiles, I ran another test at 35% brightness, And then I disabled half of the CPU cores and throttled the CPU clock all the way down to 1.2 gigahertz. The running time was less, somehow? 3 hours and 52 minutes, and I don't really have an explanation for that. It is reasonable, though, to expect the 1080p model to provide another hour or two, since it's pushing a lot less pixels. But I was hoping for a bit more time away from the wall. Well, is the Infinity Book Pro 14 right for you? I would argue it's perfect for a lot of people, but it really depends on your specific needs. The winning feature here, the standout, is that stunning 3K display that just looks painted on, and it doesn't force you to squint when you're in a bright outdoor environment. Plus, it's a really comfortable typing and touchpad experience, and Intel's 11th generation performance is surprisingly strong. This can also be a competent gaming laptop for indie games and less graphically intense titles. Coming from Tuxedo's Ryzen-powered Pulse 15, though, it's tough to swallow this laptop's battery life. On the other hand, the Infinity Book Pro's display outshines pretty much anything in its class, and it is the best overall display I've ever used. My advice is always this. Check out other reviews too. Jump into the Linux for Everyone Telegram or Discord or Matrix and ask existing customers how they like theirs. That's going to wrap up this review of the Infinity Book Pro 14 from Tuxedo Computers. If you need me to clarify anything or if you have other questions, drop them in the comments. And if you liked the review, consider subscribing to the channel because there is a lot more Linux hardware goodness coming up soon. Until the next video, you all take care and take care of each other. See ya.